Hi, good evening, and welcome to the 2017 Online Tiny House Summit. I'm Sarah Isabella, and today we have a community presentation with Carmen Shank. She's going to be speaking to us about lessons that my tiny house taught me. Take it away, Carmen.
Hey, hi everybody. Thanks for joining me, and please check me out on social media. I am Carmen Shank, and welcome. I'm not here to talk about floor plans or materials or construction or composting toilets, okay? You get that all from somebody else. That's not what I'm here to talk about. So today I want to tell you about the lessons my tiny house taught me, and also answer the question, how does it feel to go tiny? Okay, so if you're not sure you can do it and you've been thinking about this tiny house thing, you want to kind of get a feel for it without, you know, spending a lot of money and then finding out you can't do it, hang on, hang out with me for a few minutes and we'll maybe take some of the mystery out of it, okay? So my husband and I, this is my guy, this is Xavier Wilhelmy, and he is a pipe organ builder. And he couldn't be with me today, but he's out there working on a pipe organ somewhere. And this is our little dog, Ella. She's a sweet little girl. She's a beagle blend, and so she's loud and affectionate both. She's my sweet girl. And we also have a little parakeet, and so that's the family. And it's just us in our tiny house. And we started in 2014 with a really fast transition. We didn't have time to build a tiny house. We are self-employed, so we couldn't take the time off work. And we're too broke to buy a custom tiny home. So we bought an RV and made a transformation. And so this is our home sweet home. And this is a... This is what it looked like when I decorated for Christmas. I found that little Christmas ornament, and so that's our joke. This is what it means to decorate for Christmas at my place. So the goal for us for living in our RV in our little tiny space was to live this way until we could save up enough money to buy land and build a house and to do this debt-free. And I don't think either of us expected it to be something that would change everything. We just thought it was a means to an end. We knew there was a big trend about people building these really cool spaces, but ours was ready-made, and it was the right price, and it just kind of all happened at the right moment. So we really didn't expect it to change everything, but then it did. So anytime you go from what you're used to, which is the great big box, into what you're not used to, there are going to be some moments when it's just plain uncomfortable. You're trying to fit the big life into the tiny little box, and it doesn't work. And this is so much more than selling your sofa on Craigslist or giving away all your shoes. Ladies, can I get a witness? Giving away all your shoes. So it's so much more. It actually has to happen up here, because if you make that transition into a small space without changing what happens up here, it is going to be uncomfortable. It's probably going to be a little uncomfortable at first anyway, just because the transition is a challenge, I think, for everybody. If you're used to a big house, it's going to be a transition. So in the first year, I had a real frustration with social media, because there was all of this stuff about how great it was to live in a teeny tiny little house, and I was struggling with it. It was a real transition for us. I mean, you can tell this is all the floor space we have. We don't have a loft. It's a main floor bed. This is our kitchen, and this is our living room and our dining room and our foyer and everything. This is it, you know? So that's our experience. That's what it's like to live in our little space. And so I was frustrated with what I was seeing on social media, which was living tiny is the solution to every problem you have. And it's not. I'll just let you know that right now. It's not. So there is that. And I think it was because it was so early on in the process, and it was really, I was really feeling the transition, you know. In that stage, I was just really fighting with it. And so I was telling people, you know, you really shouldn't do this. You really shouldn't take this plunge. It's frustrating. And there's parts of it that are actually more expensive. And I was in that transition period, and it was uncomfortable. And you could tell by the way I talked about living tiny. So then things began to change. So if you're in that process where you're considering it, there are a number of things you really should do. One of them is visit a tiny house and just look around and see how it feels. We visited a tiny house that had wood ceilings that were really low. There wasn't like this big open space above. It felt so claustrophobic. Experiment, you know, live in an RV for a week or two. We're still in the experiment stage because we still live in the RV, but it's an expensive choice to build an actual tiny house. So this was a easily reversible decision that we made. And in the end, when it really comes down to it, and you're frustrated and you're struggling because there's not enough space, the actual solution is really as simple as wait it out. Just wait it out, because this was normal at one point, and at some point, if you wait long enough, this will be normal. And it's just a matter of time, and you just wait it out. I did experience claustrophobia, but I also found a solution. This real honest to goodness solution for claustrophobia is get up and move. Get out of the situation, go outside, turn around, come back in. Claustrophobia is uncomfortable, but it's also temporary. And you can choose to change your situation so that you don't experience it. So once I realized that it was that easy, then I didn't deal with claustrophobia anymore. So I think you may find that that's similar. So if you're going into this with the fear that claustrophobia may kick your butt, don't worry. Just get up and move. It'll be fine. And perhaps the biggest lesson I learned is focus. Focus on the positive stuff. The reason we've been so successful at living in a tiny house for so long is because we chose to be. And because we focused on the positive parts. Now, Xavier and I owned a restaurant. Let me show you some pictures. And my husband is a pipe organ builder. And so I was running the restaurant while he was out working with pipe organs all over the place. And he was gone a lot. And I was busy making cupcakes. And we became kind of famous in the community for doing musical events and having concerts in the space, serving really great food and having really great music. And it was both really amazing. It was also exhausting and horrible and painful because he was away doing his thing and here I was doing my thing. And I found him late in life, and I was not crazy about spending so much time away from him. And so what I discovered was that it really mattered to me to live closer with him than this life made possible. So we sat down and we had this conversation, and in the end, we put the restaurant on the market, and that was that. Because being connected with him mattered. And I guess you can say it's a sacrifice, but not really, because what we've gained has been amazing. So a while later, we moved into our 125 square foot house. And so how do you go from cooking in this huge kitchen and having this amazing dining room and all the equipment you can imagine, and then try to cook a meal in a teeny little house that's 125 square feet And I didn't have the dishwasher. I didn't have the blender and the food processor and the KitchenAid and all of the gear. Suddenly I had to cook a meal without all of the gear. And that's when it got really, really tricky, because what I didn't realize is that simplicity, simplicity and poverty are not the same thing. Are you hearing me? Simplicity and poverty are not the same thing. And I was confusing the two. I was talking to myself about living in poverty. And in reality, what I needed to do was embrace a life of simplicity. And that is a matter of focus. How do you like my little cards, right? It's a matter of focus, and it changes everything, because simplicity is a choice and poverty is really uncomfortable, right? So we can make a choice and understand the difference. And again, that has nothing to do with how many shoes you're going to put where, or anything to do with your composting toilet. That's what happens up here. And it's important for that change to happen, or living tiny can be kind of miserable. So suddenly I'm in this tiny little kitchen and I'm learning to cook in a completely different way. And when I took a step back from it and really looked at what I was doing, I was making food the old school way. I was working with a cutting board and a good knife and a gas range. And let me see if I can find you a picture of our kitchen. Oh, anyway, I'm not sure where the picture is, but I was learning to cook in a very old school way. And suddenly it wasn't about any of the gear. And the gear makes the food faster, but it doesn't make the food better. And this is pavlova. This is one of my new favorite things to cook. And it's meringue and whipped cream, and it's amazing. And with the KitchenAid, I can make this in like 3 minutes. But I can also make it with a whisk in my tiny house with no, you know, no grand help. I can literally do what they have done for centuries and whip cream and whip meringue with just a whisk. And to me, it has become about, cooking has become something altogether different. It's become meditation. It has become a way of focusing my energy and to take the time to really cook in a way that says I love you and that says I care about you. And so that's why I'm taking the time to make something special. And so it has really focused that whole idea of cooking with love in a way that cooking in my grand restaurant didn't do for me. And so I blame this on going tiny. And I think it's been a remarkable change. But again, you can focus on not having space, or you can go simple. And I would totally recommend going hardcore simple, because the further you take the simplicity part of it, the more you'll gain out of your square footage. So you've probably seen some of these books. The Life-Changing Magic of Tidying Up. This is a good one. Joshua Becker, The More of Less. I follow him on Facebook, and he's providing amazing content on how to live a minimalist life, which I think is another word for living simply. The Zero Waste Home is also really quite interesting. And that's for those of us who want to live in a more green way and not just squish everything into a small space and still use all the plastic and all the single serve convenience foods. You know, that the zero waste approach is more about respecting the earth and, you know, getting rid of all that nasty plastic stuff. So one of the ways I embraced simplicity in my house is that the range is not, the burners on the top of the range are fantastic, and I love cooking with gas. But the bottom part where the oven is a little iffy. So I gave up baking. And I was really feeling it. I was feeling the poverty of giving up baking. And then I realized, this is the choice. I can change my focus And I can, so I called up my mom and I said, can I come bake in your house? And so we had this great day and we baked a whole bunch of stuff. And I got a bunch of pictures to use in my blog for the recipes that I've written. And it was great fun. We had so much fun. And then I also realized, you know, this is a no-brainer, but I, of course, had to learn it the hard way. I can go to the farmer's market and buy amazing homemade stuff. And there's also a sweet little Spanish bakery that's about 45 minutes from us. And when I'm in the area, I can pick up bread that's amazing. And we can enjoy that all week long. So it's not a choice of, okay, I'm just going to give up baking because I don't like my oven. It's actually an opportunity to be creative. Because if you focus on, oh, something I can't do, I'm going to be miserable about it. Or you can say, you know what? Okay, so I can't bake at my house right now. This is a temporary situation. I'm going to get creative and learn another way around it. So I make pavlova a lot. I love it. And all of that gear, the KitchenAid, the immersion blender, the Vitamix, the Breville sous chef, the waffle irons, all that stuff, well, with maybe the exception of waffle irons, none of that stuff actually makes the food better. It may make it faster, but it doesn't make the food better. So when it really comes down to it, the way I make the food matters. And the pure simplicity of working with a good knife on a cutting board matters, and it matters to me, and that's one of the lessons that my tiny house has taught me, that I can cook without all the gear, and it's absolutely liberating because my food is still good and maybe even better than it has ever been. So January, we went on vacation to our favorite Airbnb, and this is this amazing house. It's Frank Lloyd Wright inspired. And we've been there a number of times, and we adore the guy who owns the place. And love, love, love. Oh, and we got snowed in. So a number of things happened, and a number of things came to light that made me realize that living tiny had really changed me. And one of the things that happened was I'm speaking to my husband, and I'm talking along, and then I realize he didn't hear me. He doesn't even know I'm speaking. And you know, when you live in the teeny tiny little house, the acoustics are different in here, and you can say something and be heard without actually having to project or anything. And in this house where we were, all that vast open space, I had to, what I feel, was yell to be heard. And I didn't like that. I didn't like the feeling because it made me feel isolated. The space was so big and actually really glorious space, but it made me feel isolated. I was in this amazing kitchen, and of course we go to the Airbnb where I can cook because this is, you know, there's this marvelous range over here and they've got everything you could possibly need in this kitchen, right? So in theory, I should love this because it's the opposite of my tiny house, right? But I'm over here on this side of the kitchen and I need something on the other side. So I'm walking clear across and I'm walking clear and I'm exhausted and I haven't gotten much done because I'm walking around this gorgeous, ginormous kitchen. And then it hits me. I love my tiny kitchen because everything is right there. There's so much efficiency built in. And it hadn't occurred to me how inefficient this gorgeous kitchen is. And that was just one of those moments when you realize simplicity is actually really a cool thing. There's a huge TV on the other wall that you can't see in this picture. And so I was watching a documentary while I was baking, and it was about minimalism, and I was just loving it. And so I said something to Xavier about it, and he's like, what? He had been in the other room and he hadn't even heard anything. He hadn't even heard the TV was on because, you know, he wasn't that far away. But again, it was a moment when I really felt the isolation, because in a teeny tiny little house, honest to Pete, if that TV is on, everybody hears it. Everybody knows what's on TV. If you've got a house on, I mean, if you've got a TV on at 125 square feet, trust me, everybody knows. So it was just this weird moment. You know, we're enjoying our vacation. It's fantastic. And then I realized we were in the shared space, but we hadn't had the same, we weren't connected. And it just kind of struck me. Now, we're not the kind of people that have to be together every second. That's not what I'm saying. You know, we both value our private space and quiet time, and sometimes we like to have just be together and be quiet. And, you know, it's not that we need to be together every second. I mean, we're self-employed, so we're not going to be together that all the time. But our tiny house has led us to this feeling that we are connected and that we share an intimacy that we didn't experience on vacation when we were in this gorgeous home. And it just brought it home to me how much it has mattered to me that we live in a tiny house that brings us literally together and figuratively together as well. It's brought us closer. Our teeny tiny little house has brought us closer. And then in this Airbnb, our host had gone off on a business trip and came, and I knew he was coming back. He would get back the same day we were leaving. And I knew he'd been sick, and I knew this conference was exhausting, and I knew he had guests on Monday night. So I'm thinking, okay, I'm just going to clean up after us a little bit to just make it easier so that when he gets home, he doesn't have to clean up after us because he's got people coming Monday night. So, okay, now in my house, I can have the house clean by 10, clean by noon, and seriously hardcore Mennonite clean by 3, okay? So it's 10 o'clock in the Airbnb, and I have got no progress. It's noon in the Airbnb, and I've made a little teeny tiny bit of progress. And we had a 4-hour trip ahead of us, so we needed to get on the road, and finally, I gave up. Now, I lived in that big house on the golf course. I remember that house was never clean, and I hated that feeling. But see, here's the beautiful part of living in a tiny house. And I mean this so seriously. Cleaning house is not my life's work. And when I live in a tiny house, it doesn't have to be. If I were to go back to living in that marvelous big house, I would do nothing but clean. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. So, go tiny. That, you know, seriously, isn't this enough reason right here to go tiny? Because cleaning is not all it's cracked up to be. So when we moved into our tiny home, we were in a little bit of a financial spot. You know how they say how to make a small fortune. Start with a large fortune and open a restaurant, right? Been there, done that. So we're digging ourselves out of a hole. My husband is a pipe organ builder. Let's see if I can find that picture. And he is the first in the world to have created pipe organ pipes from glass, which I think is really amazing. And I'm not sure if this picture is really coming through, but trust me, it's amazing. So, and it matters to us to take these old instruments and bring them back to life and make them glorious again. This is a very old school art form, and it matters. It matters that these voices are not lost and they're not all replaced with electronics. This matters to us. And so living tiny has made it possible for us to live in the feast and famine world of pipe organ building and be fine and be okay.
It's good. And because pipe organs matter to us, it's all been part of it. So month after month with no mortgage, because we bought our RV with cash straight up, has made it possible for us to pay this bill and that bill and the other bill. And now after a couple of different parking places, we're living in a place where our rent is $60 and our electricity bill is usually in the neighborhood of $10 or so. Seriously, I'm not joking. And we're off grid, so our water bill is nothing. And no mortgage, no water bill. Can you imagine? Now, look, I know that this is a unique situation in the tiny house world. I know that most people are not getting by on that little bit of money. I understand, but this is amazing. And after a couple of months, it's made a difference here and there. And then after a couple of more months, it made a difference here and there. And then after a couple of more months, it made more of a difference. And before long, we saw a car that we wanted, not needed, because we've got other cars. We saw a car that we wanted, and we bought it with cash. And then my husband's truck started acting up, and so we put a new engine in it. And then that only lasted 3,000 miles. So Xavier saw two ads on Craigslist and accidentally set up to meet them both in the same day. And literally left the house with enough money to buy both trucks in case he wasn't sure which one was the right truck for us. He could buy them both, bring them home, drive them for a month, and then we'd sell whichever one we didn't want. I've never been able to buy a vehicle in such a stress-free way, and I'm loving it. So he actually only came home with one truck, but the experience of buying vehicles in such a completely stress-free manner has changed everything. Now you can go and live in your tiny house and not change anything about your financial situation. You can still live beyond your means and still spend more money than you make, and you'll still be uncomfortable, okay? However, and I think this is the secret of living tiny, if you pay as you go, if you refuse debt in all of its forms, I know, look, I hear what you're saying, and I know how weird this sounds, but I am serious. I am serious. You really can pay as you go. In this culture, in this debt-ridden culture, you can pay as you go. Now, there, Helen and Scott Meering wrote a memoir called The Good Life, and this has been, I think it was in the 60s, and they're absolute proponents of this idea of pay as you go. And their story is amazing, and you should read it. If you don't, oh, and guess what? This is an unusual goal, I realize. A credit score of 0. I'm not pulling your leg. I'm for real in this, okay? Because you can still live in that teeny tiny little house and make the sacrifice of space, but blow it all by spending money that, you know, more money than you make. And then what's the point? You know, what's the point of it all if that's how it's going to work out? Oh, and I forgot to mention, one of the other things that I love about living tiny is that we're close to nature. In the winter, I can turn off the heat, turn off the air in the summer, and actually feel the temperature changes that happen in the space, in the beyond my space, as the day progresses. For a while, we were living up on a hill, south-facing, during the winter. And it was amazing how it started out really cold in the morning, and then I could kind of tell when to turn off the heat and open the windows. So in the middle of the day, in the winter, up there on that south-facing slope, I was literally having the air just very comfortably blow through my home. I was closer to the birds, to what was happening around me. When a skunk walked by right under my house, I knew it. you know, when the rabbits and the squirrels and everybody hung out right by the house, I knew it and was cool. And so this is one of those things, being closer to nature, that I don't want to give up. Okay. Now let's see, where are we? Where am I? Living Tiny has, oops, where am I? There we go. Has given us the opportunity to live more with more gratitude in our lives. And that's one of those little keys to happiness that they don't tell you in school. Gratitude is huge. And it's also given us the opportunity to be generous, which is another one of those little keys to life that they don't tell you in school, being generous. And so one example is, friends of ours invited us over at noon on a Thursday to have lunch. And I hadn't seen her in, I don't know, decades. So it was this she cooked this amazing meal. We sat down at noon, and I happened to glance at the clock at 3:30. Now, look, we do that whole lunch hour thing and meet a friend and then scoot on. But it was 3:30, and we were still having a fantastic time. And it was just one of those moments when I was so grateful for the tiny house experience, because it gave me the opportunity to be generous with my time, generous to hang out with an old friend that I hadn't seen for a long time. And we had a great time. Also, another example of generosity with time was November of last year is November of each year is National Novel Writing Month, NaNoWriMo. You may have heard of it. If you're a writer, then you've heard of it. And I generously gave myself the opportunity to spend the month of November focused, really, really focused on writing a first draft of the book. And I did. I won it. I actually got the 50,000 words down on paper, and I was so, so happy about that. And Living Tiny has given us the opportunity to be generous in more ways than just time. I've got a stack of books here to show you. We took the Financial Peace University class, Dave Ramsey. You don't have to believe all his politics to really gain something exceptional from the class. And the very last session of the whole class, the whole reason why you get out of debt, the whole reason why you spend so much energy on paying attention, make sure your insurance and your this and your that and the other thing is all as it should be, is so that you can be generous. Is this a theme yet? And see, here's the thing. If you are a religious person, then you already know about generosity. But see, you don't have to be religious to understand generosity. Our political situation has gone a little weird lately, shall we say, okay? And there's been some destabilization, and some of those institutions that we've all been counting on all this time have kind of gotten a little bit iffy. And so now is a really good time for people to step up and be generous. But you can't step up and be generous if you don't have any money, and if you're living right there at the very limit of your budget, or if you're living, if you're, God forbid, spending more than you make, then you're really in trouble. But if you want to be generous and give money to those causes that really matter to you, especially in a time when some of that's being destabilized, you really have to live below your means. And that's where Tiny House helps. And that's where really focusing in, like this class teaches, really focusing in on how is it that you go about making the changes so that Living Tiny isn't useless, you know, that it actually really starts to make a big difference. So there's a couple of books here I will tell you. Oh, did I already show you those? I think I already showed you those. This one is another one. I just started reading this one. I think it's really interesting. This is kind of a spiritual perspective on simplicity, freedom of simplicity, finding harmony in a complex world. Well, who couldn't use that? And then when true simplicity is gained, finding spiritual clarity in a complex world. I'm seeing some things here. This is a meditation on one page. It's meditation on the other page. It's picture. And They're, oh, I'm so like show and tell, Vanna White deal. So this is a really good book. I've enjoyed that one too. I love books, can you tell? Okay, so if you ever wanted to know how it feels to live tiny, now you're used to this and you're going into the tiny space, I'll tell you, it's uncomfortable, okay? At first, it's like, oh, isn't it sweet? I love my little house. And then the honeymoon wears off and you're like, oh crap, I don't have enough space to do what I want to do, and it's driving me nuts. But here's the thing. It is possible to use tiny house living to get out of debt and to embrace less materialism, less consumerism, less plastic, hallelujah, less plastic, and to live in a way that's good for environment and it's simpler and better for us physically, and more intimacy never hurts, right, ladies? Anyway, because, you know, and this is a good side effect, because cleaning house is not my calling. But here's the thing. At the beginning of this process, I had drawn this picture in my mind of my dream house. And it was 1,200 square feet, and it was glorious. But here's the thing. I don't want to give up all of that I have gained by going tiny. And so suddenly this 1,200 square foot dream house that's up here that, you know, living tiny was supposed to get me closer to, the dream has changed. The dream has changed. Living tiny has changed me so that I don't want to give up what I've gained. I want to still be able to focus. I want to still be able to be connected to my husband and to share an intimate kind of lifestyle with him. I want to still be able to work on pipe organs and take a contract I like and don't take a contract I don't like. I want to still be able to, I still want to live debt-free and have that financial freedom because I've had a taste of it and really love it. I want to write my tiny house memoir. I started it in November of last year with National Novel Writing Month, and I'm going to finish it hopefully soon. And you know what? Generosity matters to me. And the tiny house thing has really helped me understand the difference between poverty and simplicity, because people, these are not the same thing. So, in my dream house does include a tub and a place to do laundry, and a bed that you can walk around, because that's what we don't have right now, and no loft, a closet, did I mention that? So it's the tiny house dream now has actually changed the larger dream of buying land and building a house, and now I'll build a small house and not a normal big house. Thank you for coming along on a tiny house summit. Lessons I learned from my tiny house. I am Carmen Shank, and I hope you will look me up on social media and tell me what you thought of this class, this little session, and look me up. I blog about tiny house living at www.onetinylittlehome.com, and there's recipes and stuff like that there. You can also look me up on www.carmenshank.com, and I blog about books and food and yarn and words there. So please come along and say hi to me. Find me somewhere and say hi. And thank you for tuning in. It's been great to see you all. At least I hope I will see you all. Okay? Thanks.